Thank you. not safe. They can't afford to do it because you never know what might be produced. But we believers, as children of God, we're actually the only ones that get to live according to that romantic model. And it's more than romantic, it's realistic. It's realistic if you're in Christ, if Christ has given you that new resurrected heart. So we've been talking about this environment of grace. And we ask the question, what is the new covenant? Well, one way I like to summarize it is that it's a promise between God and God. Hebrews 6 says, by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled to take hold of the hope set before us may be greatly encouraged. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. So I want you to notice the two unchangeable things. And this is a core doctrine, a staple food of our movement as we celebrate God's grace. I mean, on one side, you've got the unchanging God, the immutable, the one who never acts differently. He is always consistent. You can always count on his truthfulness. And then, on the other side, you have the immutable God, the unchangeable God, who is the incredible promise keeper. And by God and God, these two unchangeable things, you are held together, locked in a covenant that you didn't start, that you don't sustain, that you don't maintain, and he takes care of it on both sides. And then it says, this is the hope we have as an anchor for the soul. So what's anchoring you? What's your anchor? What's holding you down? What gives you security? Is it your promise keeping to God, or is it God's promise keeping to himself? And that's what Hebrews 6 tells us. Likewise, in Hebrews 7, it says concerning this new covenant that Jesus lives forever. Therefore, he has a permanent priesthood. He's able to save completely those who come to God through him. Why? Because he always lives to intercede for them. It's not because you always live right. It's not because you always live good. It's not because you live so consistently. Notice that it's because he always lives to represent you, and that's for any sin imaginable. So when you put these together, you see what the new covenant is. It's something that God started with a promise to himself, and he's never changing. And then in the midst of it, we've got Jesus' life and the duration of Jesus' life, that you will be saved as long as Jesus lives. So it's not about you and what you're doing. It's about Jesus and how long he's living. And that's forever. So you will be saved completely and forever.
Oh, my God.
Now, that's just the tip of the iceberg. We talked about when the new covenant began. And that's a pretty big deal, too, right? Remember that the word will or the word testament or the word covenant is the same in the original language. And Hebrews tells us in the case of a will, you've got to have a death. It never takes effect while the one who made it is living. In fact, the law requires that everything be cleansed with blood, and without blood, there's no forgiveness. So in the Old Testament, God did this in that graphic way. I mean, he said, here comes a covenant. It's called the Old Covenant. Moses comes down from the mountain. He slaughters animals, collects the blood, and splashes the people with it. And that's pretty graphic. God did that, if you recall. He did that in order to teach us something. A covenant doesn't go into force without blood. Now, likewise, the new covenant didn't go into effect until there was blood. The blood of Christ. And so it is the cross that is the dividing line of human history. I know what you're used to. Like me, you grew up in a Christian environment, and perhaps you thought that the beginning of the New Testament was in Matthew chapter 1. You know, with baby Jesus in a manger, Matthew 1, you flip back one page, and what does it say in big block letters? The New Testament. And we assume that if the publisher put that there, that it must be right. Now, of course, I understand why the publisher put it there, because there's hundreds of years between Malachi and Matthew. But what is so crucial and critical to understand is that the true beginning of the New Covenant, the real start to the New Testament era, is not in Matthew 1, not at the birth of Christ, but at his death. And so we're invited to make a 33-year shift in our understanding. And that's why Galatians 4 says that Jesus was born under the law, and then it says that his audience was under the law. Now, you know, I received an email this week. Someone says, I thought I may have misunderstood you. You're saying that some of Jesus' teachings are law-based? Well, there's no misunderstanding there. That's exactly what we're saying. When Jesus says, you have heard it taught, don't commit adultery, but I say don't look. You have heard it taught, don't commit murder, but I say don't even get angry with somebody. If you're ticked off at them, it's the same as shooting them. What? Yes, this is Jesus showing us the spirit of the law. And so you've got it right. Some of Jesus' teachings, some of them, are designed to bury us under the condemnation of the law so that we will see our need for God's grace. Luke chapter 22, he raises the glass. He says, this is the new covenant in my blood. And you'll notice he says, in my blood, not in my birth. The Lord's Supper, something that we celebrate often around here, is a visual reminder of the true beginning of the new covenant. This is the new covenant in my blood, not baby Jesus in Bethlehem, but Jesus Christ hanging on a cross, blood all over him, a visual reminder at the Lord's Supper that it is the blood of Christ that brought in the new covenant. All right, so then the logical question is, what do I do with two-thirds of my Bible? Hello, two-thirds of my Bible. What is my relationship to the law? Well, of course, we want to say at the outset here, the whole Bible is the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation. It's inspired. You learn in Genesis how we got here. You learn in Exodus about the people who are trying to remain faithful.
Oh, my gosh.
He's showing them mercy, and there's eventually escape from Egypt. You learn about David in the Old Testament, a man after God's own heart. You learn about Solomon and the wisdom of the Lord. You learn so many things about the mercy and kindness of God, about who we are and what we did wrong and going rogue, and how God pursued us anyway. Well, the Old Testament is filled with incredible wisdom for us, and it is the Word of God. But if you ask a discerning believer, what is your relationship to the law? You know what they should say? None. Zero. Zilch. I have no spiritual relationship with the law. I'm dead to it, and I'm not under it. You know, the scripture says this in Galatians 5, verse 18. If you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now, I want you to notice that this verse is not about getting saved. I can't tell you how many times in my Christian life people have told me, well, yeah, but Galatians, I mean, that's just about getting saved. Galatians, that's just about justification. When Paul talks about grace to those Galatians, he's just talking about you know, getting right with God initially. And of course, we don't get right with God by the law, so we agree. Well, actually, when you take a deeper look at a passage like this one, Paul's not talking about salvation, is he? He says, if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. He's talking about what leads you. He's talking about who guides you. He's talking about where you get your guidance from on a daily basis. If you are led internally by the person of Christ, then you're not under the law and you're not led daily by the law. Galatians 3 says something similar, verse 25. Now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor known as the law. Remember, the law led you to Christ. The law said to you in 600 plus ways, the law said you're dead and you need life. But now that faith has come, and has it? I mean, hasn't faith come into your life? Do you not have faith in Jesus? Well, if faith has come, then you're no longer under the law, period. We don't flirt with the law. We don't play with the law. We don't mix the law in. We don't compromise with a bit of law. We're told to jettison, to hit the eject button and jettison away from life under law and trust in God. Romans 7 says it as strongly as a person could say it. But now, we have been, past tense, we have been released from the law, having died to that by which we were bound, so that we serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Do you see what this is about? I mean, is this just about some sort of 1975 hippie freedom? I'm not under law, dude. No, this is about serving. This is not about rebelling and engaging in lawlessness, in chaos or sin. This is about how God wants you and me to serve. This is about serving the Lord. But what we've got to do is catch the newsflash. Because the newsflash is, there's a new way to serve. And it's in this newness of God's Spirit, not in the old way of the law. So, it's about bearing fruit. Romans 7 says, so that we can bear fruit for God. It's about fruit bearing. It's about serving the Lord. Isn't that what you want? That's what I want. I want to serve the Lord, but if I use Moses to serve the Lord, then I'm cheating on Jesus. Whether I realize it or not, God wants me to look to his Son, fix my eyes on him, call him my life, call him my everything, admit that he's enough, and do that free fall into Jesus plus nothing. Galatians 2, through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. Again, you see what it's about? You want to live to God? Well, you die to the law in order to live to God. I want to live for God. I want him to be impressed with me. I want to live for him. Well, if you've ever said that and wondered how to do it, it's completely upside down. It's counterintuitive. It's counter to religion. It is dying to the law. No rules-based system, no legalism, no regulations, not being constrained by externals, but instead dying to those things so that you can live to God. Now, I got to tell you, that's not just counterintuitive, it's fun. And how many Christians do you know that are having fun? Well, Galatians 2 invites us to a life of fun. I'm not saying the world is always fun and our circumstances are not fun, but connection with Jesus is fun. The fruit of the Spirit is joy. He says his commands are not burdensome. He says it's easy and light and restful. All of that stuff is real. Are you having fun in your connection with God? I know the kids aren't always fun. school's not always fun. Work's not always fun. People are not always fun. But if you're connected to Christ, God's intention is that you enjoy Him and that He enjoy you. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. Can it get any clearer? Christ is the end. It's over. Your relationship with law-based living has come to a literal end. So it's not about following rules either. Somebody says, well, you know, we still need Christian principles, we need rules, we need something, family values, conservative regulations or ideas or policies. We need this to live by, to motivate us. Paul says the opposite. You died with Christ. Why do you submit to rules as if you belong to the world? Who do you think you are, an unbeliever? That's what he's saying. These rules, they have the appearance of wisdom, but look what he says. They're no good. They do nothing. They don't accomplish anything. They don't restrain you. They don't hold back the flesh. They lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. Do they look good? Oh, yeah. I mean, they look good to other people. Other people tout their rule-keeping. You know, Jesus called them on this, doesn't he, 2,000 years ago? Hey, if you're fasting, how about you polish up your face? How about you go ahead and look, put some color in your face so people don't know you're fasting? Oh, you wanted them to know you're fasting. Oh, you wanted them to ask you about your fasting. Oh, so you wanted to show off your rule-keeping and your self-discipline and your self-improvement. You know what Jesus is saying? He's saying the same thing that Colossians 2 says here. All of that stuff looks good and smells good, but it lacks any value in making you spiritual or restraining sin. It's an absolute religious joke. Speaking of rules, Colossians 3 says, let the peace of Christ rule. You know, Paul uses this word rule a few times in his letters, and I love it because here's one. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. You were called into one body. Be thankful. So it's not about rules. It's about letting the peace of Christ rule. And also, he says to the Galatians, you know, the only thing that matters is a new creation. And then he says, everybody who will walk by that rule will experience peace. And you just want to shake Paul and say, walk by what rule? What rule are you talking about? Paul, give me the rule. In the previous verse, here's the context. He's saying, let the new creation rule. It's the rule of the new creation. And here in Colossians, he says, let the peace of Christ rule. So what if it's not about rules? What if it's about letting Jesus rule? Big difference. All right, so there are commands, though. I mean, you know, even in the Old Testament, there was a prophecy that something would be written on our hearts. And isn't that what we're talking about? Hey, Christian, what kind of heart do you have? Hey, Christian, what kind of environment do you thrive in? Well, part of that is knowing what's written on your heart. What commands are in there? John 13, Jesus says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And friends, that's what's written on your heart. I know there's been some confusion in Christian communities around the world. We've heard people teach things like, the law is written on your heart now. Doesn't that sound good? Well, it makes no sense in actuality, right? I mean, imagine trying to believe some sort of doctrine like, I'm dead to the law, but it's written on my heart. I'm free from the law, but it's written on my heart. Christ is the end of the law, but apparently it's written on my heart. That makes no sense. It's double talk. It's a total contradiction. And here in John 13, we get just a glimpse of what is actually written on our hearts. It's a new commandment. Love others even as I've loved you. And we see it in 1 John as well, in 1 John chapter 3, this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. You know, elsewhere, we're told that the only thing that matters is faith expressing itself through love. Don't we see that here in 1 John? Believe and love. Faith and love. These are the things that God has etched on the binding of your new obedient resurrection heart where Jesus lives. That's what's written on. Faith in him, trust in him, dependency on him, and love, an inborn love that he poured in there, that's what's written on your heart. And we see that love is everything. I mean, the world tries to tell us this, even with their flavor of love. Love is in the air. Love is all you need. We hear these things, and yet doesn't Scripture tell us that the love of Christ is what it's all about? Romans 13, love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. In other words, you could sum up every command God has ever given into this idea of God's love for us and God's love for other people exuded through us. And man, if we're Jesus-focused and love-focused, everything else, it totally takes care of itself. 1 Peter says this. The Apostle Peter, he says, above all, that means over top of everything else, number one priority. You're trying to figure out the Christian life. Here it is. Above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sins. Look, you say, but I'm pretty sure I need that thou shalt not murder thing. Well, you can't love somebody and murder them. I'm pretty sure I need that command about thou shalt not commit adultery. You can't love your spouse and commit adultery on them. I'm pretty sure I need that thou shalt not lie. I've got a lying problem.
Well,
love someone, you don't lie to them. You can't lie and love at the same time. Do you see that the love of Christ covers a multitude of sins? Why are we crying out for Moses when we've got Jesus? All right, here are a few final thoughts about this environment of grace and this new heart that we have through Jesus. Colossians chapter 2 says this, therefore, as you received Christ Jesus, so walk in him. So let me ask you, how did you start in Christ? Did you start by the Ten Commandments? Did you start by rule keeping? Did you start by saying, God, look at me and all I'm doing for you? Is that how you started? Of course not. Any born-again believer says, I'll tell you how I started. I started by saying, I can't. I can't save myself. I can't be perfect like God is perfect. I can't earn. I can't achieve. I can't do it. You can, and I'm going to let you. So likewise, this says, as you receive Christ, so walk in him. So tomorrow when you wake up and you're beginning your day, what's the attitude that wins? What's the attitude that works? The attitude that wins is this. Lord Jesus Christ, I can't do it. I mean, I look at the fruit of the Spirit and it's overwhelming. I have no power. I have no source apart from you. So I can't. But you can, and I'm going to let you. And that is what it means to walk in him the same way that you got started. Galatians 5 tells us about this freedom, this environment of grace that we're in. And you know what it says? It says you've got a decision to make, my friend. God's brought the freedom. Jesus brought it. It was for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm there. Don't let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. You've got a decision to make. You notice it's on you? This one's on you. God did it all. Jesus prepared everything. It's finished. Freedom and liberty hand delivered. The question is, are you going to let yourself be tangled in religious bondage again? Or will you believe it? No longer calling it Walt Disney Fantasyland, but calling it Christian reality, that because of Christ and what he's done to you, you don't need rules, regulations, or laws. You can live from this heart and be yourself and express Jesus at the exact same time without any conflict, because you're not an obstacle. You're an instrument. You're a perfect fit. The perfect you is a perfect fit with a perfect God, because he gave you a perfect heart. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the liberty that's in Christ. Even in the scripture, we read that people came in to spy it out. They came in to observe it. They didn't know what to think of it. So much freedom, so much celebration, so much joy. Father, that's what we long to celebrate with you. And we know the door and the gate is Christ. We know that it basically comes down to saying, I believe you did it all, and I believe you did it perfectly, and I believe you did it right, and I believe it was enough, and I believe that I am forgiven and righteous and holy and blameless and close. I believe. When we declare that we believe you, Father, there is just the peace that rules. There is a Savior that makes himself known to us. We are grateful. In his name we pray.
ゲームはこちら。
これもあんまりな、
誰だよ。
タンはわかんない。
タン
はわかんないですか。タンも。
それはそのあのプラスで受けられない。
あ、わかった。時間オーバーやったらもう5分以上。
あ、もう無条件で。
な、な、な2秒待つからな。1、2。はい。
早いっす
よ。あと2秒、1、2。はい。もう銭湯もうこんなあかんでよ、お前
誰で行かせてください。お願いします、お願いします、お願いします。
しかも二文字やもん、そりゃあかんわ。ダニーニンニンニやったよ。
ニンニンニンニン行きます。うわ
ー、もう一発で行く。1、
ダン
来るで、来るで。
2、
やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、や
ばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やば
い、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、や
ばい、やばい、やばい、や
ばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、や
ばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、やばい、や
マグネチ
トンだ、
マグネチトンだ、前のこと
や。エザーで見ながら
行きます。